Welcome back, everybody, to Raven Star's Witching Hour. If you'd like to call in, the number is 347-688-2902 or Freedom Screen on Skype, and I'm here with Robin Andrews. And Robin, are you there?
I'm here.
Great. And if you want to continue on with that story about that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So let's see. We will put the...
let's see.
He was... I was speaking at the UFO conference, and this colonel from Fort McPherson, which is in Atlanta, came up to me, and he said, I had mentioned the story about the... In fact, I had a picture that the man had drawn of the three-star general. And he said, I think I can get you a photograph of that general. He said, there are not that many three-star generals to begin with, and I only know of one that was like Air Force attached to Army. And so he sent me a photograph and the name of a man, and he collected patches, so he's very interested in the drawing of that meticulous drawing the man had made of that patch and all. And he sent me a bunch of patches. And I had planned to go back down there and take that picture, but to take some other sort of like make a lineup, you know,
mm-hmm.
and see. But I haven't been able to do that yet. But it's something on the agenda.
Oh wow! Yeah, no kidding. Be interesting if it matches up with something. But did you ever run into any threatening situations due to the type of research and regressions you have been involved in by covert intelligence areas?
You mean threatening to me?
Yeah, or maybe one of your clients or anything like that?
Not to myself, like the man at Contel. I told you he was threatened about his job if he didn't shut up about talking about that. But you know, because I do a lot of research about this anyway, there's a list about 4 or 5 feet long of UFO researchers who have mysteriously died in the last several years. And Dr. John Mack, who was a Harvard Medical College psychiatrist who worked at, you know, was a professor and worked at Harvard. And the last 10 years, I knew him well from many conferences. The last 10 years of his career, all he did was UFO abduction research, exactly what I was doing. And we had had many discussions about that. Well, he was in London, I don't know, maybe a year ago, and to give a talk, and he was crossing a crosswalk. And in London, of course, is in Atlanta, a pedestrian has a right of way. Well, he was run down by a drunk driver. And that could be what happened, or it could be suspicious. But the same day in London, another man named John Mack was run down by a drunk driver, which I thought was very curious.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
And so, anyway, I haven't encountered anything. And, you know, I just usually speak my mind about whatever I know, and like I'm talking now, and there are things that could threaten certain people, but I haven't ever so far, knock on wood, experienced any attacks or problems.
That's good to hear. And I know you also did some kind of work with the Montauk Boys as well, right?
Right, I did. Al Bailey, first of all, I helped bring him to Atlanta a long time ago when he was first getting started really speaking. And he stayed at my house several times and got to know him really well over the years. And then he moved to Atlanta. And then his brother came here, Cameron, who was Duncan Cameron, who was supposedly a Montauk boy and one of the boys that was imprisoned there and used in the experiments they did. And I had met him a long time ago at a conference, but he came here and I did a lot of regression work with him. Lovely, lovely person. And he had told me that when he was a boy, and he, you know, these boys were supposedly, a lot of them were supposedly abducted off the streets of New York. But anyway, he said that he was put in this special chair, and he I think there's a book with a picture of that, a sketch of that chair, not a photograph, but a sketch maybe that he had done. He said that his whole body was wired up, including his genitals, and that they used some technology that Wilhelm Reich, who developed the organ energy and all, he had said at some time that if you could harness the male orgasm and sustain it, that you would have the creative force to create anything you wanted to. Well, of course, it is a creative force in a way. It makes new life and all. But anyway, so he said that that's what they did to him, that they induced arousal, erection, orgasm, and they sustained it for a long time. And somehow he was brainwashed, I guess. I don't know exactly how they forced him to do it, but he would visualize things that they wanted to create. And so there were pictures in this book they had of a huge, almost a King Kong type of monster. And obviously it must have been some sort of an astral creature, but it practically destroyed the base. It just tore everything up. And they had a hard time, I think, getting rid of it. And I'm not totally clear on how all that happens, but anyway, that's the story in the book. And he was one of the victims of it. Well, much later, when he was grown, of course, I met a woman named Helga Morrow at a conference in maybe at Global Sciences. And she said that her father was an engineer or scientist working in the Montauk base at that time, and that he used to take her down in the base when she was a young girl. So she got a video camera, and she and Al Bielek and Duncan Cameron and Preston Nichols, who was somehow involved in all this, a scientist, and maybe a couple of other people, went down, and this is maybe in the 90s, they got in the base. It was evidently shut down at that time, and they went down in there and photographed all where all this took place. And I have a video of that, and she videoed the cages where some of the young boys were kept. And so evidently some horrible things were done to young men. And I'm not sure, but I believe that they said they like to get blind young men. A lot of them were. Now, Duncan was not, I don't think he was abducted off the streets, but just, you know, Al Bielek was on, both of them were on the Philadelphia experiment. And of course that was later. And they claimed that they jumped off the boat when the ship disappeared from view. And that's another whole story.
Oh yeah, it's incredible too. And yeah, I've heard horror stories about that Montauk and the Montauk boys. I've heard a lot of negative things about it, so that makes sense to me.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, and insofar as Duncan goes, when you did a regression on him, did you notice any anomalies in the atmosphere? I mean, I know he's kind of a time traveler in a sense. I'm wondering if it affected anything like
that. Well, the only thing was that I regressed him at someone else's house where he was staying, and it was already late when we started. And after I put him under, there became a point where he said a few things, but then he was way off somewhere. He could not hear me, and I could not reach him at all, and I could not wake him up. And it was several hours. I didn't know what to do. Everyone in the house was asleep, and I thought, I cannot go and leave him. And so I just had to wait, and eventually he gradually came back to consciousness. He could not hear me. I could not reach him in any way with my voice or, you know, anything. So I don't know where he went, but probably, you know, these people are brainwashed and everything, so they may be, I know a lot about mind control, about the government's program of mind control, and I know that, you know, some people are programmed, if they start to remember things, that they'll even commit suicide or something.
Right, yeah.
So, anyway, that thankfully that didn't happen to him, but anyway, he was a lovely person.
Yeah, he sounds like a good person. You know, it's interesting because I know they do the psychotronic programming and a lot of what you're talking about with the Montauk chair, because I have a background in that too, with the covert technology and mind control, and I swear it just completely kind of dovetails insofar as what they're doing with deploying psychotronic weapons against the mind and then screen memories and mind control. And then some of these abductees you talk about, you know, with the military, that sounds like a MyLab, a military abduction. So it's really interesting how this is all playing out.
Well, Stephen Greer wrote a paper about that, and I had noticed for years that a certain, not all of them, but a number of abductions occurred around military families on military bases, and I noticed that was a lot of prevalence of that. And so he wrote that not all of the abductions, but that some of them around military bases are being faked by our government. And he said they have the technology, they have UFOs, they have, he said they have some kind of a, I don't know whether it's a robot or, he didn't go into great detail, but he said it would fool anybody that looked like an alien that would, you know, carry out the abductions. And this is his take on this now. I'm just quoting what he said. He said that they wanted these people to hate the aliens so that they could implement the Star Wars program. And so that's why they were focusing on military people. But, you know, Stephen Greer put on that disclosure project thing where a lot of military brass testified that they had seen ships come and disarm the nuclear facilities at their bases, and they had witnessed that. So, but anyway, I had noticed that a certain number of people were military, and I don't know that I could tell a lot of difference about their abductions, but are you familiar with Leah Haley?
Mm-hmm.
I remember that she used to talk a lot about of the military, you know, abducting her and trying to find out. It was real confusing there. They were trying to find out what the aliens would do, and she would be abducted by the aliens and then by the military and all kind of strange things.
Right. That seems to be a pattern, too. I noticed with abductees, anybody who's had interaction with a quote-unquote off-world race usually gets tracked by government and military.
Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And that's another thing. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to tell about one lady that, it's because so many of these people had never heard of, even didn't know anything about and throwing up and everything. And she said all of a sudden they turned on all the showers and the water to drown out his screams and everything. And so in a little while, she sees that they're bringing medical gurney and all kind of medical personnel and equipment in. And then when they get in the room, in a few minutes, she hears him screaming, "No, no, no." And then after a while, everything gets real quiet. And then after a while, she sees them furtively loading all that equipment on a van that's right outside that door. And so she didn't know what was going on. So anyway, this lady, I've been to Huntsville I've been going for 25 years speaking over there, so I'm very well known over there, and I speak at colleges and MUFON and all kind of different places over there. Well, so there's a friend I always stay with, and she was driving me to the college. This lady who related this story was a friend of hers who was in the car with us. And as we're driving to the college, she said, "Would you like to hear my story?" So she starts telling me this story. Well, we got to the college before she finished. So they had just gotten in the room, and she had heard this musical sound. That's about as far as, and then later that night, she told me the rest of the story. Well, I asked if I could speak about it, and she said yes. So, of course, I didn't say it was her, who, where, but this man kept coming up to me at the breaks. I think it was an all-day workshop or something. And he kept coming up to me asking me, he said, "Was that a movie?" And I said, "I don't know. Maybe it was. Maybe she just thinks she..." But anyway, he said, "I know this." And he was very disturbed about it. It was like I had triggered a memory for him. And so finally, the next day, he called, because we'd given out the number where it said. He called and insisted that he had to see me. So finally, someone went with me, and we went to a place where he was, and I recorded. And he was so disturbed. He said, "You have opened up a can of worms for me." And he said, "I saw it all." And so he starts to describe what had happened in that room. He said that was... He said they needed that sound, so there was a whole recording studio set up in there to record that sound that that creature made. And he said because they were rushing her so and trying to keep her covered, she bit one of them on the leg. And he said he had a horrible allergic reaction. His leg swelled up, and he got very sick, and they were afraid he was going to die. And so they had to get the doctors in there and amputate his leg. Well, that fit with what she had told me, because she didn't know that had happened or anything. But, so I said, "Well, why did they, why were they recording that?" And he said, "Well, I saw it all on the monitors." And I said, "What are you talking about?" And, he said, "Well, don't on the control room, I saw it all." And I said, "I didn't know what he was talking about." And he said, "Don't you know what a NASA control room looks like?" And I said, "No, why would I know that?" And he said, "That hotel is a front." And he said he was in another room, and the whole wall was a bank of monitors. And he said some of them were showing what was going on in that room. And others were showing a secret, now get this, community that the government had somewhere, a hidden secret community that was totally controlled and, you know, mm-hmm. by the government. He said everything, it was some kind of experiment. He said that everything had been going very well, but that it was about to blow up. It was getting very disruptive. He said, "If we play this sound this creature makes, they'll all go back to work and settle down, and everything will be peaceful again." So he said that they had just sort of requisitioned that creature to come. Evidently, she had been brought to this planet evidently that same day. I don't know the particulars of that part, but that's all he said. And I kept asking, I said, "Well, did you ever work for NASA?" And he would say, "I don't know." And he was so disturbed. I had triggered a lot of memories for him, and he didn't know the whole thing, but he knew this part of it.
Wow.
And so I don't know. Until yet, I don't know what happened after that or what, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm trying to do some writing about it. I thought it'd make a good science fiction story because nobody would believe it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's fascinating. I almost wonder if he was remote viewing or something, and he has a remote viewing ability, you know, where he's just kind of tapping into something. That's really interesting. I was wondering, also, do you ever get interference with your sessions? I think I asked you this before, but do you get anything where your sessions get interrupted with anything electrical or your radio shows?
No, except that one I described where the tape recorder's got jammed. I haven't had anything that I thought was like government-type interference or anything, no.
I just thought I'd ask because we had a little issue with a server there for a second, but we're okay. I guess we're back on air and everything's good. So we had a little drop-off there for a second. But I wanted to switch gears a little bit, if we could, and talk a little bit about the René Le Chateau mysteries and the secrets of the Templars and what you've discovered with your research.
Well, I back in the mid-90s, I started taking groups there, and we went to, of course, to René Le Chateau, and we would take them to all the other sacred sites in Provence and the Languedoc, and we took them to the places where the ship with Joseph of Arimathea. Well, the story is that, of course, that the Holy Blood, Holy Grail brought a lot of this out, but that Jesus and Mary Magdalene were married, and there's a lot of evidence, a lot of stories in the Bible and things that point to that. But anyway, the ship is supposed to have landed in the Mediterranean at this little village called St. Marie de la Mer, which means the St. Mary's of the Sea. Joseph of Arimathea was Jesus' uncle, although I've read some books where he has a different relationship, but he's related somehow. Anyway, he was a wealthy tin trader, and he brought 500 refugees from the Holy Land after the crucifixion because they were all in great danger after that, and so they came to the shores of France. It was called Gaul in those days, and so in this little village, every year for hundreds of years, they've had a festival commemorating that, and I've been to it many times, and about 10,000 people, many of them gypsies from all over France come, because Saint Sarah was on the ship, and some books say that she was Mary Magdalene and Jesus' daughter, and others say she was the dark one, that, you know, dark skin. And I don't know, but this is their saint. And there's this little church that was built in the 6th century there in that little village. It's a very little village. And the gypsies start arriving about a few days before, and they have all their beautiful gypsy wagons all painted up. Their horses are all decorated. They've got on their finery, and they have parades and everything. And so this church was built in the 6th century, and the downstairs part of the church, like what you would call a basement, they call it the crypt, is where the gypsies go, and they have the statue of Saint Sarah is down there, and they take her out in the water on one of the days on a horse, and all behind her were many, many piles of crutches and braces and things that people had been healed, and they just throw them back in the corner. They were piles, and they're supposed to give them to hospitals every so often. Well, the walls were covered, floor to ceiling, wall to wall, all the way around with written testimonies of healings. They're little framed written things, their tiles, their paintings, all kind of things. It's solid, all the frames are touching each other. And then and there's so many candles you can't even breathe. And then upstairs, the same thing, the walls are covered with these testimonies. And there's a little boat on the wall with two figures, the two two of the Marys, Mary Jacobi and Mary Salome, were biblical figures who were supposed to be on the boat. And so they take that, and they stayed there. Mary Magdalene and some of the others are supposed to have left after they landed, but these two Marys stayed there, so that's why they call it the Saint Marys of the Sea, Saint Marie de la Mer. and they take that boat way out of the way on horses, and they take it way out into the water during the ceremony. So it's real interesting, fascinating celebration. And then about maybe 30 minutes from there, there's a cave that's up on the side of a cliff, and it takes about an hour going through an exquisite, supposed to be a virgin forest, and they cut some steps and little shrines along the way, and you go up there, and this big open cave where she's supposed to have lived about 30 years, the last 30 years of her life. And the Catholic Church has now built a kind of a chapel in there, and then there's a monastery built into the next to it that takes care of it. But back when she was living there, obviously she had some, she was like a disciple who came to France and taught and had a great following. And of course, women weren't supposed to be taught any of the mysteries or anything back then, but she was supposedly one of the greatest, and if she was the wife of Jesus, then it would have been even more significant for her to have a following. And then some people think that Jesus came, and of course the book Holy Blood, Holy Grail intimates that Jesus survived the crucifixion. Sometimes I think maybe he had a great near-death experience. But there are all kinds of theories about the crucifixion, so I'm not going to go into that right now. But he, one book I read said that he went to India, and it gives a great deal of evidence for that. But some people think he later came back to Rennes-le-Château. Some people think that he and Mary Magdalene lived at Rennes-le-Château. Rennes-le-Château is a little mountain about 1,700 feet high in Languedoc, which is, you know, just above Provence in the western, southwest of France. And it's, and now there are only about 30 houses. Well, this place is panoramic. When you're there, you can see all the way around for many, many miles. You see every village in every direction. So it's always been a strategic sort of place. And they said at one time, much in the past, there were 40,000, it was Redet, it was a city of 40,000 people, but the hordes from Spain and all came, and attacks and wars and everything. So now, what happened with our story is that this priest came there around the turn of the century in the late 1800s, and he was a very intelligent man, and he was very well schooled, and so everybody thought this was a very poor outpost for him to be sent to, because they just considered it a backwater sort of a place. It didn't even have a roads down the mountain, and there were no running water, and there is a water source up there, though. So since Neolithic times, you can tell that it's been used. Even dinosaurs are found up there, the bones and all. But anyway, so he came there, and this little church built in about the 5th or 6th century was there, and it was falling apart, and the presbytery where he had to live was falling apart. And there's a chateau there, a very ancient chateau that was owned by one of these families that's supposed to be what we call part of a bloodline. And so somebody gave him enough money to remodel the church. And while he was doing that, in one of the pillows, he found some glass tubes with some documents in them. And those documents were strange and in code, and he couldn't really tell what they meant, so he's finally advised to take them to Paris to the Church of Saint Sulpice, which was mentioned in the Da Vinci Code, but not in the way it really is. But it's a very metaphysical church, and an occult church. And there's an obelisk. I've been there. There's an obelisk in the church And this is where the Paris Meridian begins, right there. Well, we're supposed to have had Paris Mean Time instead of Greenwich Mean Time. There was a big argument about that, and finally the Greenwich thing won out. But anyway, this meridian runs right down through Rennes-le-Château and through other very significant places. It's the sacred geometry involved in this place is just incredible, and I don't know how to bring it fully into picture right now, but if you study it, it's just amazing. And so anyway, when he came back to after he spent some time in Paris, and when he came back, he became like a multimillionaire almost overnight. And to this day, nobody knows for sure where his wealth came from. So he remodeled the church. He gave all the villagers much money. They were very poor. He gave them all very generous sums. He built a road down the mountain. He fixed the water, you know, running water and everything. Well, he built a great big villa, and he built a tower to Mary Magdalene. And actually, there are two towers. There's it's connected by a long terrace to a glass tower that they call an orangerie. Back in those days, oranges were very rare, and people would raise them in like greenhouses. And so it's sort of a glass tower that they supposedly had exotic plants in. And then he built all these exotic gardens and fountains and fruit trees and all kind of things. Now, he did not live in this house, as I understand it, but he entertained many very illustrious people who came there after he had made these discoveries. And the Habsburgs came very often. And some people think that this is where his money came from. Others think that the Vatican paid him off to keep the secret, because if the fact that Jesus and Mary Magdalene were married was known, they believed it would have destroyed the church, because it was based on a, you know, celibate priesthood and everything. And so anyway, he was they're supposed to have been there are many tales of great Templar treasure and all kind of things that are hidden there. When I worked with an archaeologist who lived there in Rennes-le-Château, and I knew many of the residents there quite well because I spent so much time there. And he was secretly tunneling under the village. Now, it was illegal to tunnel, but he had built a shed in his backyard, and the tunnel started in that shed. So whenever he had to use any noisy equipment, people that were tunneling, he was too old to get down in the hole, and then they would run this noisy wood-cutting equipment to drown out. But anyway, I did very much dowsing and remote viewing and regressions and psychic stuff, all kind of to help him see where to dig. And suppose the tunnel was coming from the old chateau next door, which had one time been in the hands of the Templars. And obviously the Cathars were there at one time too, and the Cathars were also guardians of some of the great secrets of the what they call the Holy Grail, and nobody knows what that is for sure. The book intimated that the Holy Grail is really the bloodline, and some intimate that it's the secrets of alchemy, and on and on and on and on, endless rumors about this. But I just finished reading a book about Girona, which is a city in Spain, and it has a tower there, and the tower he built was called, dedicated to Mary Magdalene as well as the church. It was called Tour de Magdala, and it was an exact copy of the tower that was in Girona. Girona is a very mystical city very ancient and goes back to, and was at once a great, evidently great Kabbalah center, which was the Jewish mysteries. And they said that the priest, Abbe Saunier, who was the priest at Rennes-le-Château, he was a very charismatic, very handsome man, that he came there very often. And there was a woman there who lived in the house with the tower, and supposedly they had a love affair. But he's also rumored to have had a love affair with Emma Calvet, who was he met in Paris. You know, this is a time when they had all the occult salons in Paris, and people like Simone de Beauvoir and all these occult salons. And Emma Calvet was a great occultist there, and so he was introduced to a lot of this, and so somehow this all figures in part of the mysteries. And but they said that he came to Girona very often for many years, and that he exactly copied the tower there, which was called the Tour de Magala. And so many of the secrets of the artifacts and things were hidden in Girona, and he brought things there, documents and all kind of artifacts that he had found that he wanted kept, and they'd been kept sacred and hidden for centuries. And well, there's a secret society called the Prior de Sion, S-I-O-N, that people like Claude Debussy, Da Vinci, Victor Hugo, many people that you would all recognize had been the Grand Masters, and that the sole purpose of this secret society was to protect the bloodline and the secrets about this. And there are all kind of disputes about this and arguments and controversies, but that was kind of what the book put out. And there's supposed to be a present direct descendant who lives in Paris, who's a Pierre de Plantard, Pierre St. Clair Plantard, I believe I've got his name right, and he has a son, so he doesn't talk too much. He will talk some, but he was very vague about, but he was supposedly the last, is supposedly head of it now, and supposedly maybe the direct descendant. And so anyway, the Merovingians were descendants of this bloodline, and many of them were stamped out during the Albigensian Crusades by the Vatican, when the Cathars were wiped out by the Vatican. They killed 1 million people there, slaughtered them, because they were, even though they were Christians, they would not join the Catholic Church and would not say the Pope was infallible. So they just slaughtered over 1 million people, and they took all these fabulous lands in Languedoc. And they were very well off people and very, very high spiritual group, and they were called the Pure Ones. And so they were at one time, I think a lot of them were at Rennes-le-Château. But I wanted to tell about, well, I found two mysteries myself that I haven't really seen anyone else. There's a sweet little hotel just below Rennes-le-Château, but on the side of the mountain, little French hotel, and I've stayed there many times with the group. And they own several hundred acres that had been in the family for, you know, centuries. Well, the French Bibliothèque Society took some aerial photos of that area, which was just, you know, wooded area. And it was very interesting. I have pictures of that they took, and there was a huge, in the subsoil, image of a Madonna figure with two babies, and also a sort of a jackal-looking figure. And this is huge. I mean, over several hundred acres. It spread out, this, and it was in the subsoil. And they have, and it's very distinct, and they have no idea how it was put there or why it was put there. But I think it was, it could not have been recovered until they had aerial photography and infrared photography. but it seemed to point to the significance of the place of the Holy Family to Rennes-le-Château. And there's another area that's kind of a farm, like place there's a bed and breakfast, say, and they have an organic farm. And they found a statue of Mary Magdalene down in the woods near an old broken spring that had some rock work around. They restored it. And they said at one time that had been a Templar stronghold. And they said that people in villages for miles around would come there to get that water because it was sacred to the Holy Family, even though this beautiful, they're all kind of wonderful spring, Roman spring towns within driving 15 miles here and they all around. But they would, and they just think they had to walk or ride a horse back then, but they would come and up this mountain to get that water because it was sacred. And so another thing that I found that points to some of the sacredness of the place was, well, they got a new mayor at one point while I was going there. And the first thing he did was get a bulldozer, and he went down there's this water source that travels from Rennes-le-Château up to meanders down the mountain. Well, where he went, it took us over an hour to climb down there over some, you know, rocky areas, and it was quite hard to get to climbing. I don't know how he got a bulldozer down there, but there was a pond down there, a shallow, clear pond, and he dug out a huge Templar stone that he somehow had found out was there. I didn't know about it before. It was just under the sand. It had a Templar cross on it. Well, the Templars are supposed to have been the guardians of the secrets. Well, he immediately took it out of the country, and he was from Spain, possibly Basque. And so he was fired, he was fined, he was indicted, he got into all kind of trouble for taking this out, and they've been trying ever since to get it back. I don't know if they have yet. But anyway, one couple, a German couple who have a house at Rennes-le-Château that were very good friends of mine, were members of a secret society called the Knights Templar that seems to be a continuation of the old society, but now they allow women, and so both he and his wife are members. He told me that he was told by them that this stone was there because this is where Christ was buried. Hmm. Now, that's all I know. I don't know any details more about that, but there's so many things that point to, you know, the connection of this place. Right. And suppose at least Mary Magdalene was there a long time. The Templars were there. We don't know whether Jesus was or not. But this archaeologist that I worked with, he died several years ago while I was over there. But he was really onto quite a lot of things. And I'm sorry that he wasn't able to finish his work.
Definitely. And Robin, we're getting ready to almost wrap this up. I can't believe these 2 hours flew by as quickly as they did. But let me go ahead and I just want to thank you for being on the show tonight. It's been incredible to have you on and really appreciate it. I hope to have you back, too, because we have much more to discuss about this. And I do want to thank everybody for tuning in tonight, everybody, Revolution Radio chat room listeners and producers. And make sure you join me next week when my special guest will be Mary Rodwell. And stay tuned for Shiny Side Out with David Dunder and Mackie coming up next to sell you on into the night from Down Under. And, of course, we do have a few more minutes there, Robin. So let's go ahead and wrap this up. And what else can you cover in the next maybe three or 4 minutes?
I don't know. I was hoping to talk about my friend that was in a morgue refrigerator for 3 days, but
wow! Can you get that out in 2 minutes or less?
Well, All I know is he woke up during the autopsy and he had been put in the morgue on Friday, and on Monday he woke up in the autopsy and he was in a refrigerator the whole time. This was in Russia, and he was a very good friend of mine. He came to this country, and that's how we got to go back to Russia later, Raymond Moody and I and Daniel Brinkley, why we were invited back because of him. But this story's been verified by the Discovery Channel, who went over and interviewed the doctors and verified his whole story. He was a famous dissident over there, and this is why the KGB tried to kill him, and they tried so hard they ran over him twice. At the same time, you know, circled around and ran over him again. That's why he was put in the morgue. They said he was dead. So then he became a priest after that and a famous dissident. The whole story is just fantastic.
Wow.
And eventually he had to get out of the country and he came to Houston. But a lovely, lovely person. He died several years ago, and I think that may have been suspicious too. But
sounds like it. What year did that happen where he wound up in the morgue?
I think it was around 87 or 88.
Holy cow. That's incredible. I'll have to have you back so you can cover that in more detail.
Oh, yeah. It's a fascinating story. He was born in the gulag, yeah. Parents were political prisoners, yeah.
Wow. And so if anybody wants to get a hold of you, your email is the best way to do that, right?
Right. RobinAndrews912@gmail.com. Robin with a Y.
That's right. And also, so are you working on your book right now. So any idea when that's going to be released?
Well, I would have had it done already, but I had a bout with pneumonia recently and also a bout with my computer going down. So I had to delay finishing it up, but I hope by the first of the year maybe I can have it ready.
Excellent. Yeah, and I'm hoping that you don't still have pneumonia. Are you doing better now? You sound like you were a little calmer.
Much better now, yes.
Good. I'm glad to hear that. I'm really, really happy to have you on tonight, so I really want to thank you again for being here. Hopefully I can get you back on in the next few months. It's been great.
Okay,
I love things too. Yeah. Is there anything else you wanted to add real quick? I think we might have just maybe a minute left, but is there anything...
The older book that I did a few years ago is called Prodigies, Extraterrestrial Telepathic Intelligence Phenomena, but it's $12 and I can still, you know, send those out. They have to order them from me, but they're $12 if anybody contacts me.
Awesome. Sounds like a really
and
good
it's
book.
Mostly about that prodigy group that I was talking about and about the twin thing, you know.
Mm-hmm. I find that very, very interesting, especially the ones with the children, you know, with the births, you know, the twins, and then yet there's only one.
Oh, right. Yeah, that's fascinating.
Mm-hmm. Makes you wonder. Well, I do think there's a lot of military abductions going on right now with covert intelligence and a lot of mixed programs that are running.
Yeah, well, Stephen Greer says the ones at the military bases are mostly faked. And so I don't know, but I think that's something to investigate.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, it seems to me like most of the inductions or abductions are usually connected to military and underground bases. Yeah, and then some real ones as well. But very, very interesting. And how many years have you been doing this, Robin?
Oh, since 1970.
Wow, that's incredible. That's a long time.
Yeah, right, it is. About 45 years, I guess.
Yeah, are you still going to be doing any lectures or anything soon?
Oh, yes, uh-huh.
Okay, do you have anything coming up?
I don't know. I have to check my schedule. I'm sorry. I'm not near my calendar right
now.
That's
okay. Yeah, let me know, and I'll make sure I promote that for you. I'll put it on my Facebook page.
Great. Okay. Oh, thank you.
Sure. Oh, yeah, definitely. So I thought our clock was going to, you know, we're kind of off on time and the illusion of time tonight. I don't know why. We've had a little bit of a server glitch and then a few other things, but nothing major. But anyways, I did want to thank you again, and hopefully we'll talk maybe a little bit more about Montauk the next time you're on, too. You still stay in touch with those guys or no?
Al Bielek died recently.
Right, and Preston Nichols and Duncan, are you still staying in touch with them or...?
I haven't talked to him in quite a while, but I have a friend who's in touch with him, so I could get in touch with him.
That's good. Yeah, I was just wondering how they're doing and what they're up to. So I haven't. I talked to Preston Nichols several years back, but I haven't spoken to him in a while, and I'm trying to get Duncan to get on my show, so we'll see what happens. All right, everybody. Yes, thank you, Robin.
Maybe I can find him if you need access to it.
Okay, well, thank you, Robin, for being on. I so appreciate it. Everybody have a great weekend, and I'll see you next week.
Okay, thank you.
Listening to Revolution Radio.